So our next two colligative properties look very, very similar. And they are boiling point elevation and freezing point depression. Now again, I recommend that you learn the qualifier that goes along with colligative property so you know which way the change is going to occur. But their equations look very, very similar. Their calculations are very similar. So we'll talk about them together. Okay, so the first one is boiling point elevation. Now we know what the definition of boiling point is. We don't say it's the temperature it boils, although that's what, you know, the general population would say. We make it a little more complicated than that. It's a temperature at which the vapor pressure, now the vapor pressure goes up as the temperature goes up, and eventually the vapor pressure matches the external pressure. When that happens, it starts to do that rolling boil that we recognize when, you know, we see something boil. But when the vapor pressure equals the external atmospheric pressure, that is what boiling point is. Now, we know, based upon Raoult's law, that non-volatile solutes will lower the vapor pressure, okay? If it's going to lower the vapor pressure, and vapor pressure is a part of the definition of boiling point, it goes hand in hand that adding a solute is going to affect it as well, okay? So we know that it's going to affect it, and let's see how. Let's look at this graph, and let's move over to the screen here and kind of focus in on what's going on. According to the diagram, and we look at it here, and we're looking at the boiling point end of things, okay? Look at it and compare the boiling point of the solution with the boiling point of the pure solvent. Now there's dashed lines there, and it tells you what the dashed lines represent. They represent the solution. So choose your answer. Well, certainly we see that the boiling point of the solution is higher in temperature than the boiling point of the pure solvent. And we already know, even if you didn't know that, we've learned a name for it. It's boiling point elevation. So we're going to know that the boiling point is going to go up, and we've seen this phase diagram before. We see why it's going up there. And here is the relationship. The change in temperature of the boiling point is proportional to molality. And it's molality, that's a little m, molality of particles. So we see that Vant Hoff factor in there. It's not the molality you see on the label on the bottle, it's a molality of particles. Now if we're going to turn a proportionality into an equality, we add a constant. And this constant is called the boiling point elevation constant. Didn't they give it a clever name? Boiling point elevation constant. Now this boiling point, or that change in temperature, is how much it's being elevated by, okay? So it is always a positive value, and so that's something I keep in mind so I know the order, because the order is going to change if it's the boiling point elevation versus the freezing point depression. I don't worry about it, I just know that the change, it has to go in as a positive number because it's an equality. I can't make them equal if one side's positive and one side's negative. So that's how much it's being elevated by, and that's what I always remember. That's how much it went up by, okay? I do this arrangement. It's different than the book's arrangement typically because it spells my name. My name is Kim, K-I-M, all right? So the constant times the Vant Hoff factor times the molality, all right? We know that I times M is concentration of particles, and I told you the name of that. And this you'll have to do, either be given to you in the problem, or you might have to do a web search. But it has everything to do about the solvent. What is the solvent? It doesn't matter the solute. All that matters for the solute is what is the concentration, okay? Because a colligative property is dependent upon the concentration. What this constant is doing is telling me, what is this slope like? I know it's going up. I know it's going up in a linear fashion, but it's changing depending upon what the solvent is, how steep that linear relationship is, okay? So some things are affected more drastically by the number of particles, and some things less drastically by the number of particles, okay? So be aware, the slope, which is that constant, is dependent upon the solvent. Where we are on that line is dependent upon the concentration of particles. Okay, so that's boiling point elevation. Let's go to the other side of thing. It's called freezing point depression. So let's go back to the graph again. And what does the addition of the solvent do to the freezing point? So once again, we'll compare the dashed line, which is the freezing point of the solution. Where does it hit? It's hitting up here, versus that of the pure solvent. So as we add solute and make a solution, the temperature is lower. So it is lowering it, okay? This is exactly why, and right now when I'm recording this, we're having winter weather week in and week out, and they put salt on the roads to lower that freezing point. If they lower it, then maybe the external air's temperature is higher than the freezing point, and because we've pulled it down lower, and that ice will melt on the roads. Now, the equation looks just like the other one, except we replaced all the B's with F's. And remember, freezing point and melting point are the same temperature, okay? So this could be with a little M, but it's an F, freezing point depression. Again, it's a linear relationship. Now, this is always a positive value, so they change the order of how they subtract it. But you've got to remember that when you get that delta T, this is how much it was lowered by. It's the freezing point depression. How much was it depressed by? So it's its change in temperature from where it normally freezes to where it is now freezing. So again, we have the change in temperature is equal to Kim, right? The K sub F, which is the freezing point depression constant. Okay, so we have all the similar things around this equation that I had around the other one. Freezing point depression constant is dependent upon the solvent only. It is telling you how the concentration linearly is affecting the change in temperature of that freezing point. Affect it more drastically, it's a bigger slope, or less drastically, and it's a lower slope. And so that is the equations we use for both the freezing point depression, freezing point depression and the boiling point elevation that we did prior. So let's see how this works with a problem. I want to calculate the approximate freezing point of a solution made when 21 grams of sodium chloride are dissolved in 100 grams of water, and they gave me the freezing point depression constant value of the water. So let's work through this problem. As soon as I see that it's a freezing point depression problem, I will pull out my equation for that. The change in temperature of the freezing point is equal to the freezing point constant for freezing point depression constant times the Van Hoff factor times little m. What is little m? It's the molality, right? Now they gave me the K sub F. They told me it was 1.86 and it's degrees Celsius per molality. So for every one molar change, you're going to depress, this is freezing point depression, you're going to depress the temperature by 1.86. Well, what's the Vant Hoff factor? It's sodium chloride. How many particles does sodium chloride break apart into? It breaks apart into two, the sodium and the chloride. But what now we need next is the little m. We need the molality, and I don't know the molality yet. So what is the formula for molality? Molality is the moles of solute, and in this case it's sodium chloride, divided by the kilograms of solvent. Okay? So we've got this value, and we are going to go and calculate the moles of sodium chloride by taking the grams, which was 21.0 grams of sodium chloride, and saying, but I didn't want grams, so I'll put grams here. I want moles. And so we need the molar mass of sodium chloride, which I think is 58.44. Let's see. Yep, 58.44 grams in a mole. And when I divide that, that would give me my moles of sodium chloride. My denominator needs to be kilograms of water. They gave me that I have 100 grams of water. And you've probably gotten familiar enough now to know that you can just move the decimal place over three places, but let's go ahead and write it all out. I'm going from grams to kilograms. There are 1,000 grams in a kilogram, so that's my denominator worked out. Okay? So when I take my numerator, which is 0.359 moles, and divide it by my denominator, which is 0.1 moles, I have a molality, oops, sorry, why did I say moles? I meant kilograms. I have a molality of 3.59 moles per kilogram, or we say it's 3.459, it is 59, molal, little m. Why did I want that? Well, I was trying to do this equation up here. So let's come up here and put 3.59 molal in. That is going to give me a change in temperature of the freezing point equal to 13.4 degrees Celsius. Now, very often, students will report that as their answer. When you get an equal, you must stop and say, have I answered the question? This is how much it was depressed by. It's the freezing point depression. It went down by 13.4 degrees. It's not asking that, it's asking what is the freezing point. So where does if water, and that's what our solvent is, normally freeze at? 0 degrees Celsius. That's its normal freezing point. It's being depressed, it's going down by this amount. So I'm going to subtract 13.4 degrees Celsius. So it's a negative 13.4 degrees Celsius. If it was any other solvent in the problem, we would have told you where it normally freezes, because we don't expect you to know the normal freezing point of everything. But for water, you know that it normally freezes at zero, and if you add the solvent, it's going to depress it. It is going to go down by this amount. That's the freezing point depression. It's being depressed by this much, and so the change, or what it goes to, is a negative 13.4. So that is how you work a problem, whether it's a boiling point elevation. What would you have done here? You had added it to it. Added not to zero, but to its normal boiling point. So it's a similar process. You just got to make sure when you get to this molality and you plug it in here and get your change, that you do something with that change. It's either a freezing point depression, so you're taking it away from its normal freezing point, or it's a boiling point elevation and you're adding it to its normal boiling point. The K value is not the same for both, okay? The freezing point depression constant and the boiling point elevation constant for water are two different values, so you're making sure you're using the correct one there. Now, sometimes we'll ask you to do a calculation. Sometimes we're just going to make you do some comparisons, okay? So let's look at this problem here. Which one of these four solutions has the most particles in solution? Well, they all have the same molality, but they're different substances. The first one's magnesium chloride, then we have glucose, okay, then sodium chloride and pure water. Well, I'm very hopeful that you picked A, but if you didn't, why not? Let's see, what did you not consider? What you have to consider is the Vant Hoff factor. For the first one, the Vant Hoff factor is I is 3. This thing breaks apart into three particles. So the molality of particles is 0.3 molal. This is nonmetal galore. It's just nonmetal, so it has an I of 1. It is a non-electrolyte, so it has 0.1 molal. And then we have sodium chloride, which breaks apart into two particles, and it would have a concentration of particles of 0.2 molal. And this is pure water, so it has a concentration of 0 molal. So which one has the most particles in solution? It would be A. Now, once you know that, then you could ask questions about that. Which one would have the highest boiling point? So you're not really doing any big calculations here and calculating their boiling point. You should be able to make judgments about it, and we do it this way. Well, we know it is boiling point elevation. What does that mean? The more particles, the higher the boiling point. So which one has the most particles? It'll be the one with the highest boiling point. So you picked A, right? A has the most particles. We decided that on the previous slide. Now, if we ask the question, which one has the lowest freezing point? Well, it's freezing point depression. So the one with the most particles is also going to have the lowest freezing point. So there'd be different ways that we could ask that question. So with this slide, we're going to review the three colligative properties we've had so far. And I want you to think through each one of these terms, okay? Pause and fill in the blanks. The first one, vapor pressure what? Well, this is vapor pressure lowering. This is how we learned the name of the colligative property, vapor pressure lowering. So what does that mean? That means that vapor pressure, the pressure of that solvent is going to go down as the concentration of particles goes up. The next one, what's it called? Freezing point, they call it depression. They could have called it lowering, but they didn't choose to. It's called freezing point depression. So what does that mean? The temperature at which it freezes goes, well, it's depression. It goes down as the concentration goes up. Last one is called boiling point what? Boiling point elevation. Okay, boiling point elevation means that the temperature at which it boils is going to go up as the concentration goes up. So if you learn these by their language, then you will learn their trends. Sometimes you can answer questions just based upon these trends. And then next you would memorize their formulas and you might have to do some calculations. But when you're done with the calculation, you would always want to do a check. Did it go up? Did it go down? Did it go down? That way you have a sense of whether or not you're correct with your work. Okay, so that is our first three colligative properties, and we have one more to go, which is osmotic pressure, and we'll learn that one in our next lesson.